Well, good morning, friends. It is good to be together today. My name is John Gallaher, and I'm the lead pastor here at Embrace, and I just want to say welcome to you. I'm so glad that you decided to join us this morning and worship with us. I see some folks already interacting in the comments, and I love when y'all do that because it just brings joy to my heart to see you guys connecting and talking with one another and reflecting. And Dan, thanks for giving us our roll call every week. Dan's always faithful to say what's up to everybody he sees on the chat, so we're thankful for that. We are excited to be together today and to worship God and to connect with one another. And ultimately, my hope is that we all leave here looking more like Jesus. And so I encourage you to prepare your heart, prepare your mind, prepare your space and your body, and really try to get into a place where you can limit the distractions as best as you can, and you're in wherever you're at right now, and really try to connect with God. Maybe you want to pray a prayer right now, just in your heart and in your spirit, that God would open your entire being to receive what he needs to give you this morning. And so I'm just going to pray a short prayer, and then we'll begin by worshiping. Lord, we thank you for this wonderful opportunity we have every single week to come together, connect with each other in communion with you, Lord. God, we pray that you would meet us here in this moment, that we would feel your presence and your power and your love, and that, God, we would leave here inspired and challenged and encouraged and motivated to continue on this path of loving you and loving others and witnessing to the kingdom of God here in this world as it is in heaven. God, I pray that we would feel your loving embrace this morning as we begin to worship and praise your name. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. I'm going to turn it over to Chris and Christina, and they're going to lead us in some music as we begin our time together. So let's begin our worship in song this morning.
Oh, you are my true God. Oh, you are my true God. I will follow you to the dark. I will follow you with all my heart.
I'm not
Amen. Well, if you've just joined us during that song, welcome. So glad you're here today. My name is John, and I'm the lead pastor here at the church, and that was Chris and Christina leading us in worship this morning. I want to do something now that we do each week, and that is sharing together in community, in the comments. This is a way that we can connect with one another, catch up with each other, and hear kind of what's on our hearts and our minds. And so one thing that we've been doing for many months now, since we've been worshiping online, is sharing our praise and our protest. And our praise is, you know, those things that we're excited about, that we're grateful for, things that we want to lift up and praise God for this morning. And so hopefully you have lots of praises, lots of things that you're grateful for, lots of stuff you can give God kind of the props for. But we're also living this tension where we have gratitude and we have a lot of joy. We have a lot of praise, but we also experience a lot of sadness and difficulties. And there are things that we ought to lament and protest. The Bible is full of lament. Some say that the majority of the Psalms are lament Psalms, crying out against, protesting out against the evil and the injustice and the difficulties and pain and sorrow that we face in our lives. And so we don't want to just be all about praise and forget the protest. We don't want to be all about the protest and forget the praise, right? We want to live in that tension. And so my question for you this morning that you can share in the comments as we continue to worship is, what are you praising this morning and what are you protesting this morning? What are you praising? What are you protesting? Let's connect this morning and share a little bit and show some courage and vulnerability. And so we're going to continue to sing as we share our praise and our protest. So I'm going to turn it back over to Chris and Christina for another song.
Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow.
I'll follow you.
Amen. Well, thank you all for sharing a little bit of your praise and protest this morning. I'm not going to be able to read them all because we've got quite a bit to do today, but I do want to just look through them and maybe highlight a couple of them because some of you all maybe aren't seeing the comments if you're watching another way now on your TV maybe, or if you're listening or watching later. So I'd love to share just a couple of these real quick that I see. Alex shares that Jackie made it another cycle around the sun. Praise. Got Kathy Connor praising God for a new job for her husband, Brant. That's very exciting. So that is awesome. Kryn, one of our younger ones, that she's able to write her own book that she's working on. So that's awesome. Glad you're able to work on that. Just see if I see any others. Rick Reams, praise, answer prayers, to God be the glory. He's commenting on Kathy's post. So yeah, we do praise God for answered prayers. Often we pray for things, we ask God for things, and then we don't go back to actually, well, you know, once that prayer has been answered and something good ends up happening, we don't go back often and give God praise and glory for answering the prayer. So thank you for that. Got, you know, protesting a lot of the upheaval and violence and kind of unnecessary evil that we're seeing take place around our nation right now. And it's very discouraging and difficult to see. John Epley's praising God for having another fun night last night with the Embrace Game Night. That was a lot of fun. I was there too, and so I'm praising God for that. And also just lamenting and protesting the nervousness that a lot of people are feeling right now. With the tension and the uneasiness happening all around us. And so, yeah, that's something that we need to be thinking about and praying for sure. Sue is also lamenting the division. There's just deep, deep division and separation right now all around us, within the church even. And, you know, I think even a few years ago, there may have been one or two kind of hot button issues that would divide the church. But now it seems like almost everything has become so divisive, and it's hard for us to stay together as a church. And so that's something we really need to be thinking about. How do we stick to conviction and continue to deal with difficult things while at the same time loving and extending our embrace wide enough to include all of God's children? These are things that we need to be thinking about. Paige, I'm praising another day and I'm lamenting alcoholism and its horrid effects. Thank you for sharing that, Paige. Sonda, I'm so grateful for all your prayers and acts of kindness that she received when she had her surgery this week. Thank you very much. And we're glad that you're doing okay, Sonda, and that you're recovering. Daisy May, I'm thankful for my daughter and I'm praising God for her seventh birthday next Saturday. I'm so happy for the life he has given her through me. Amen. My wife is praising God for plans I'm looking forward to today and CG programming starting back Tuesday for the spring semester. I'm also excited for the plans today as well. And I'm also excited about Common Good starting up this upcoming week for the spring semester. And then I do want to mention one more. Dustin is protesting the 12 people who have been murdered by lethal injection by the federal government over the last several months. You may not realize this, but there's been a very rapid amount of federal executions that have taken place in the recent months within our federal government, a practice that had not been used widely at all for many, many years. And that's something that we do need to protest and lament because it, in my opinion, it is one of the darker sides of our nation and our practice and how we deal with people who have made mistakes, even serious mistakes. And it is also a very unjust practice, the death penalty. And it is, I'd be happy to talk to you more about that if you would like, but I also protest that as well. I'm not going to be able to read them all, but I encourage you, even if you're like watching on a TV and you're not seeing comments this morning, maybe get out your phone or something at some point. Just scroll through those, maybe after the service even, and see what your fellow sisters and brothers in Christ are sharing this morning about what's going on with them. So if you've just joined us recently, my name is John Gallaher, and I'm the lead pastor here at Embrace, and I just want to say welcome to you. I'm so happy that you are here and that you decided to worship with us. If you don't mind, if you haven't done this already, I would love if you would share the stream on your news feed. You can do that by, if you're on your phone, there's a little button at the bottom, hit share. Best way to do it is write a little post. More people will see it. Maybe say, hey, it's my church. Love it. Come join us. You know, there's many ways you can do that. But if you don't mind sharing it, that would be great. If you don't want to, that's okay too. But it also helps kind of expand our reach and helps other people to get connected. We've had people join us because a friend shared it on their news feed and they saw it and decided to start worshiping, and then they felt the Embrace love as they participated in our online experience. I want to just share a few announcements with you, some important things going on. I will let you know that tomorrow is Martin Luther King Jr. Day here in America. It's one of my favorite holidays that we celebrate in the United States. And so we are going to spend some time reflecting on Martin Luther King and his legacy today, a little bit later, but I just wanted to go ahead and mention that. And I'm excited about some of the things that we're going to get into. Tanya is going to share a reflection about MLK later, and I'm going to share just a few thoughts about Christian discipleship as well and how the Gospel of Mark connects us to folks like Martin Luther King and their legacy and the way that they decided to take up their cross and follow Jesus. So stick with us till the end, because we've got a lot of good stuff coming up. But let me share some announcements real quick. If you're able to give to support our ministry, you can do that at embraceyourcity.com/give. All the information there to give online or to send a check, do a recurring gift. You can do any of that. And so I just want to thank each and every one of you who have given to support our ministry here at Embrace. Thank you to those who may be giving this morning. We really appreciate it. It helps us to continue what we're doing. We've been able to keep everything going financially over the last year, even with the pandemic, because of generous folks like you. So thank you so much for your generosity. I also want to let you know that we have a prayer team. Tanya Torp, one of our associate pastors, heads up our prayer team, and she facilitates this email address, prayer@embraceyourcity.com. And so if you have a prayer request, you can put it in the comments this morning, and she's here and she'll see it. But you can also email that prayer email, and you can ask even to set up an appointment to pray. And folks have done that. And Tanya shared with me even this last week that she was able to pray with some different people who are going through some stuff. And I'm just so excited that you guys are utilizing that. Tanya's able to pray. I'm here for you as well. Christina's here for you as well. We would love to come around you and lift you up. If you're a young person in our church, Landon, who is our youth minister at the church, would love to connect with you as well and talk with you about how you're doing. And then once we get youth group started back up, be able to make that point of contact each week at our youth group meeting. But my next announcement is basically just this. We are here for you. And so if you need something, our pastoral team, we're here. Like, I know we're not meeting in person at the church right now, but we're here for you. We'd be happy to set up a Zoom call with you. We'd be happy to talk on the phone with you, to pray with you, to talk through anything that's going on. Even if you're just struggling a little bit, or you're just having some questions or thoughts or doubts, or even if something that happens here on a Sunday at Embrace makes you uncomfortable, or you have questions or concerns, or maybe you're like, I don't know if I am jiving with what they're saying, then reach out to me. John@embraceyourcity.com is my email. You can call the church as well. If you got my cell phone, you can text me or call me. But reach out to me, Christina, Tanya, Landon. We'd love to connect with you and talk through anything that you're dealing with. So we're open. We're here. We're available. Just wanted to let you know that. A couple of other just quick announcements. We do not have our sermon talk back tomorrow night. Since it's Martin Luther King Day, a holiday, we try to practice rest on those holidays and also give us a time to really reflect and just connect with each other at home or wherever it may be. But we're not going to do that sermon talk back tomorrow night, just to take a little bit of time to rest this week. And also just out of honor and celebration of that holiday. And so I'm just letting you know that now, but we'll be back the next week for our sermon talkbacks on Monday nights at 8. And then also our Monday prayer time that we're doing at 4 p.m., we're moving that to Wednesdays at 4. Okay, we're going to try out a new time. Since we already have a sermon talk back at 8 on Monday nights, we're going to move it to Wednesday to have things on different days. So Wednesdays at 4, we'll be here to pray on Zoom. We'll be posting that on our Facebook group. And then finally, the last announcement I have is our newcomer Zoom lunch is coming up next Sunday. So in a week, right after church at 12:30, we'll end our live stream. And then we'll start up that Zoom pretty quickly after that at 12:30. If you want to eat lunch while we're on the Zoom, you're welcome to do that. No, you don't have to eat lunch with us if you don't want, but come, it's going to be casual. So don't feel like you're causing a disruption if you're eating or you got your kids there. This is going to be very casual and relaxed, and we're going to share a little bit about Embrace and kind of what our church is about. We're going to be there to answer questions, talk about membership, and give you a chance to connect with each other. And so if you've been coming for quite a while now, even if you were coming before the pandemic and you've been here in person and all that, like, and you feel like you want to get to know more about Embrace and want to get to know other people, come and join us. We'll have a few of our leaders with us. My wife's going to be with us as well. And so next Sunday, if you're wanting to come and be a part of that, you can just show up. We'll send out that link. But also, it'd be nice if you could email Christina at christina@embraceyourcity.com, or you can call the church office as well to let us know that you will be there. That's my final announcement for today. So what we're going to do, I'm going to show you where we're at on our Wonder Room calendar. So we are on the second Sunday after Epiphany, and kind of in ordinary time now, And keep in mind, it's not the exact number of green tiles there for ordinary time because Lent comes a little earlier this year than last year, actually, with the way the calendar works. And so we're excited to move towards Lent and move in that direction. And so now we're going to watch our Wonder Room story, which is going to be kind of about the Bible and also about the book of Mark, which we're going to spend some time studying. And so let's watch this together.
Good morning, boys and girls, and welcome to the Wonder Room. This morning, we are going to hear a story that will prepare us for lots of other stories. So take a moment and get yourselves ready. All of the stories we hear together in the Wonder Room can actually be found in one place. They are all part of one very special book called the Bible. Many of you know what the Bible is already. Your family might have one, you might even have your own, and we have Bibles in every pew of our sanctuary here at Embrace. We have so many of them because we want everyone to be able to read the important and wonderful words inside. The Bible helps us to know and to remember all the things God has said to his people and done for his people over a very long time. The Bible is an amazing book for lots of different reasons. Many very different people over many different years helped to write the Bible. Also, the Bible is amazing because it contains lots of different kinds of words. It uses words to write songs and poetry and even letters. It uses words to tell stories about kings and prophets and ordinary people. And there are four really special books called the Gospels that tell the story of Jesus. The four different names of the Gospels are Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Though each one of these books tells the story about Jesus, they all choose to tell it a little bit differently. And in the choices they make, they help us to know something about what is important to Jesus. Our church family is going to read one of these books together. We are going to read the story about Jesus as written down by Mark. Some of the choices Mark made in deciding how to tell his story about Jesus include a focus on action. In Mark's story, Jesus is always healing and praying and resisting. Though some of the other books that tell the story about Jesus, the other Gospels, include more teaching and conversation, Mark is focused on the action. Another of the choices Mark makes in the way he tells his story is to introduce us to a cast of characters who show up in Jesus' story over and over again. The first of these characters is Jesus himself. In Mark's gospel, he makes it clear that Jesus is the hero of his story. But Jesus is no ordinary hero. He isn't rich or powerful. In fact, he makes friends with the poor and the needy, and he speaks truth, even when it makes the people in power angry. Other important characters in Mark's story are the people closest to Jesus, whom Jesus calls to come and follow him and learn to live the way he lives. These people are called the disciples. We will get to know them and learn more about them soon. Besides Jesus and the disciples, there are also lots of crowds in Mark's story. These are groups of largely poor people who are invited to be close to Jesus and to receive from him all he has to give. And finally, there are also lots of scribes and teachers of the law and religious leaders who think they know everything already about how to live. But Jesus comes along and challenges them and calls them to live a different way. It's an exciting group of characters in an action-packed story. When we read Mark's book, we get to learn about who Jesus is and some of the amazing things he has done. Now, I wonder, have you ever read one of the Gospels for yourself or with your family? I wonder what other actions Jesus will portray in Mark's story. I wonder how big some of the crowds were that gathered together in Mark's story about Jesus. What else do you wonder? What questions do you have? Type them in the comments below and we'll wonder together after this song.
All to Jesus.
Amen. Amen. It's one of those songs that I sing and I'm like, it's one of those songs I want to continue to live into the words that I'm actually saying. Because I truly do want to give all of myself to Jesus. But we know all too often we hold parts of ourselves back. And that's really the journey of Christian discipleship, is growing closer and closer to Christ, that we are willing to give up more and more and more for the sake of Christ's mission, and for the sake of his desire to see this world redeemed. And that's ultimately what I want to do. I want to continue to surrender more and more of myself to Jesus and in his way. And so hopefully that can be a prayer for you this morning, I surrender all, right? That's a beautiful prayer. I want to look and see kind of what some of the wonderings are. I see a couple few here. Tanya's just pointing out that we're talking about discipleship in the Wonder Room. Yeah, and discipleship is kind of a word that may feel a little too like of a churchy kind of word. But it's really about how do we follow Jesus? How do we follow his way and become a disciple? And we're not trying just to be believers, you know, of Jesus. There's a lot of believers out there, but we really want to be followers, where we actually commit ourselves to living out the teachings and example of Christ. Rob's pointing out, love the action, the healing and the praying and resisting. Jesus did a lot in the Gospels, but we see a lot of healing, we see a lot of praying, and we see a lot of resisting in the Gospel of Mark. And so we're highlighting those this morning. And Stacy's just wondering why Matthew, Mark, and Luke are so much similar to each other than John. And he's pointing out that these three are commonly called the Synoptic Gospels, and many believe they were based on an original source that people call Q. Has nothing to do with the Q conspiracy that we hear about these days, but it's an interesting thing that those three Gospels do have a lot in common, than John just seems to be writing in a totally different way than the others. Becky's wondering why the Gospels were written so long after Jesus died. It's a good point, yeah, and we're going to talk a little bit about that over the upcoming weeks of oral tradition, and how that was really the common way that stories were preserved and shared. But for some reason, at some point, these writers decided we need to write this down. We don't need just oral tradition. We need this to be in writing. We need to remember this. We need this to be something that we can hold on to for a very long time. So it's very interesting and a great question. Beckett, one of our young ones, wonders if the crowds had thousands of people in them. Yeah, I wonder how many people were in the crowds. That's a great question. Stacy's just continuing to wonder about the Gospels and their different kind of perspectives, and why don't we just kind of harmonize them into one? I mean, I think these are great questions. I wonder if I was one in those crowds, if I would have been drawn to him then like I am today. Praise God for Gospel authors like Mark, who helped me learn about Jesus and draw closer to him every day. Yeah, it's great, Kathy. Thank you for sharing that. Yeah, Dustin is loving the Q source, mentioning that in the comments. But thank you all for sharing some of your thoughts about that Wonder Room story. We're not going to talk too much about Mark this morning, but we are going to talk just a bit about Mark this morning, and then we're going to really get into it over the next few weeks. And so some of the things that you heard in the Wonder Room story, we're going to revisit some of that as we come along throughout, particularly Jesus calling disciples and creating community, right? Jesus's ministry and presence among the crowds, which was made up of the poor and the outcast and the oppressed. And then Jesus's confrontation with the powers and the authorities, which that happens a lot in Mark as well. And so we're going to look at those kind of three subplots as well that Christina highlighted for us in the Wonder Room story. So get ready for all that as we jump into it over the next few weeks. But this morning, I just want to briefly say a few words about Mark, and then Tanya is actually going to share with us a beautiful and powerful reflection and challenge to us related to Dr. King and the freedom movement and kind of how that can speak to us today as Christians. So as I told you last week, we are in year B of the lectionary calendar, and this morning we're actually taking a slight break from the lectionary It's kind of weird in the lectionary right now because it's in Mark for quite a few weeks in a row, but the gospel today jumps to John for just 1 week. And so we're not going to get into John this morning because we're going to do a little special thing for Martin Luther King Day. But next week, we're going to jump back into Mark. And many people have said that this is like the year of Mark, year B in the lectionary calendar. And it's because Mark is used over and over and over again throughout this entire year as the gospel reading. And so through the course of this year, we're going to spend a lot of time dealing with Mark's unique story about Jesus of Nazareth. It's unique. It's his own kind of way of telling this story that I think is pretty powerful and really speaks to a lot of our current moment that we're in right now. Today, I just want to simply share this point about Mark's gospel, all right? Mark's purpose in his gospel was essentially to inspire and teach people how to follow Jesus. He wanted to inspire and teach people how to follow Jesus. Mark was not concerned with like heady thoughts or wise sayings or pontificating on what the cross means. There is a time and place for that, and we need that. However, not in Mark's gospel. The gospel of Mark is ultimately about the way a person lives. That's what Mark is concerned with. He is concerned about the way a person lives their life. He wanted to challenge people in his gospel to be radical disciples of Jesus of Nazareth in their daily lives. Mark's gospel is full of action, all right? You will see as you read it, there is action in this gospel. There's not a lot of dialogue. There's not a lot of just preaching and teaching. There's so much action. And it's because what Mark, his kind of perspective, Mark isn't so concerned about knowing all the right things about Jesus. He is more concerned that we see how Jesus lived and that we have this model that we can follow. So we see clearly how Jesus lived, and we have a model that we can follow. Karl Marx famously said that philosophers seek to understand the world, but the point, however, is to change it. He said, philosophers seek to understand the world, but the point, however, is to change the world. And I think that Mark might well have agreed with that statement because Mark is very much about action, about doing good work. Ched Myers, who's a brilliant New Testament scholar that wrote a powerful book on the Gospel of Mark called Binding the Strong Man. And I've been reading through it a lot, and some of his work is going to inform where we go with this sermon series. But Ched Myers has appropriately given a subtitle to the Gospel of Mark, and he calls it a manifesto for Christian discipleship. A manifesto for Christian discipleship. It's a public declaration of what it means to be a disciple of Jesus. So if you want to know how to follow Jesus in a world that's full of lies and violence and propaganda and oppression and domination, read this story. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to read this story. We're going to study this story. We're going to study the world of Mark so that we can understand and learn how to be better disciples. How do we follow Jesus in our context today? During the Black Freedom Movement, there were so many people, including Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., who tried to follow Jesus in a time that was full of lies and violence and hatred, oppression and chaos and propaganda and all sorts of stuff. And today we're going to hear a reflection from Pastor Tanya Torp about Dr. King and his commitment to Jesus. And so I want to read these words from scholar Aubrey Hendricks about King and about Mark, the writer of this gospel. And so I'm going to read this for you, and then we're going to hear from Tanya. So let's hear this quote. The evangelist Mark and the preacher and activist King had much in common. They were both disciples of Jesus, writing on behalf of stressed but faith-grounded movements of social and spiritual renewal. Each was trying to speak both pastorally and prophetically into a conflictive national and international moment of war, political terror, and profound social injustice. Their respective witnesses arose from historically oppressed communities of conscience who knew plenty about resisting Pharaoh while struggling to remain human. I would even go so far as to say that King's proclamations were, like Mark's, divinely inspired by the one who stands outside the reigning imperial cosmos, calling us to discipleship. So let's hear Tanya. She shares a little bit more about what it might mean to learn from King's example and to be followers of Jesus Christ.
Morning, Embrace family. A few years ago, I traveled to Memphis, Tennessee for a conference and had the opportunity to visit the National Civil Rights Museum. After walking through what seemed like hours of exhibits of heroism, including a replica of a bus that was bombed, forcing freedom riders, including the late Representative John Lewis, who were desegregating the highways, something the law had already allowed for, to exit the bus to a waiting mob that beat them with bats, lead pipes, glass bottles, anything that they could get their hands on, I moved through the long, long line and stood next to a cardboard replica of Dr. King. I remember thinking how I thought he'd be taller. I'm 5'5½", and he was about 5'7". The tour culminated in a very emotional moment where visitors were allowed to enter the very room where King stayed, where he spent his last night and last day in the Lorraine Hotel. When it was my turn to enter room 306, I focused on the phone, the tiny black rotary phone used to call the front desk to get help for King after shots rang out. As we shuffled like cattle to the tiny balcony, though the landscape was a bit different, I stared into the same parking lot. King was looking down and speaking to the Reverend Jesse Jackson, who was innocently telling him that it was cold and that he needed to bring his jacket to dinner when the shots came. I remember feeling as if I were standing in church. At one point, I was separated from Christian and my husband and concluded the loop alone. I went outside, sat on a stoop, and sobbed, overwhelmed by sorrow. Sometimes it is tangible just how far we are from God's perfect Eden and just how much this is not our home. I also sobbed because I know the statistics. The dream that King had for a freedom in America, a freedom for all, has not been realized. In his book, Why We Can't Wait, the companion to the letter of the Birmingham jail, it was published in 1964, and within the first few chapters, he characterizes the conditions that he can no longer abide and that we must not wait to fix. Poverty caused by inequality, such as Blacks being paid less on the dollar, Blacks being excluded from labor unions, Blacks unable to sustain their families, unable to live in certain communities, unable to attend certain schools, tax-paying members of society being marginalized repeatedly with impunity. According to Dr. William Darity, who is a professor at Duke University, the relative position of Blacks has not changed economically since the March on Washington. Certainly, poverty has declined for everybody, but it has declined in a way that the proportion of Blacks to whites who are poor is about the same as it was when King gave his famous I Have a Dream speech. From the astonishing mass incarceration numbers to the infant mortality rates for Black women in America, it is evident that there is so much further that we have to go and that we were not designed for this. We were not designed to other one another. It's led to harm for everyone, for all of us, regardless of the color of our skin, because our actions often do not match our Christ-like aspirations. It strikes me as voyeuristic that one can study every aspect of King's life, from his letters to the editor in college, to his seminary grades and recommendation letters, to letters to his parents. He skipped grade 9 and 12 and entered Morehouse College at age 15. He was ordained on Wednesday, February 18th, 1948. He pastored two churches, but traveled and spoke at thousands, both in the US and abroad, making the gospel come alive and reminding us of its relevance to this moment. He went to jail 29 times, sometimes sentenced to months of hard labor. He was stabbed. He was shot at. He was hit by a rock that knocked him down to the ground on live television. He had to eulogize three of the four Black girls killed in the church bombing. But once you start to tumble down the rabbit hole of his life, you begin to ask yourself about this man who preached the gospel. How far am I willing to go to be the hands and feet of Jesus? Would I be willing to sacrifice my reputation, be thought of and treated as a criminal publicly for denouncing the evils of racism? Am I willing to be hated and hounded by government agencies, critiqued and discounted by other clergy members, people who profess my same faith? Miss important moments of my children's lives who are consistently put in danger because of my activities? Am I really willing to count the cost? In November of 1964, after King criticized the FBI's failure to protect civil rights workers, the agency's director, J. Edgar Hoover, denounced King as, quote, the most notorious liar in the country. A week later, he states that the SCLC, which is an organization that King was a part of, is spearheaded by communists and moral degenerates. In August of 1966, 63% of Americans had an unfavorable opinion of Dr. King. At his famous March on Washington, the head of the FBI at the time said, quote, personally, I believe in the light of King's powerful demagogic speech. Yesterday, he stands heads and shoulders over all other Negro leaders put together when it comes to influencing great masses of Negroes. We must mark him now, if we have not done so before, as the most dangerous Negro of the future in this nation from the standpoint of communism, the Negro and national security. Robert Kennedy said, as he was characterizing the Blacks who attempted to hold law enforcement to preserve the actual laws that had been enacted through nonviolent protest and nonviolent means, he says they were looking for trouble. Quote, Negroes are now just antagonistic and mad, and they're going to be mad at everything. You can't talk to them. My friends say even the Negro maids and servants are getting antagonistic. But I don't want to talk about King's violent death or many documented trials. I don't want to focus on the numerous quotes you'll see all over the internet over the next few days. I don't even want to talk about the trauma his children are still overcoming today. I want to talk about the fact that though he was an incredible man who accomplished extraordinary things by the age of his death at 39, he did all this in the service of Jesus. And the part of his legacy I want to focus on today is community and brotherhood. He did not accomplish one thing alone. He inspired other Christians to stand for justice and to work together to accomplish goals for the common good. His message was interdependence, not independence, and reminded congregants often that they were not just working for themselves, but for all Americans and for future generations, and that the gospel was their compass. And like the woman at the well who became the first evangelist in Samaria, he also encouraged women in leadership positions. There is no MLK without Coretta Scott King, who sacrificed her career as an accomplished classical trained singer so that her husband could pursue the Lord's call. She was in the home on January 30th, 1956, when a bomb went off. She saved herself, her child, and her friend. She orchestrated a call to John F. Kennedy to save her husband's life, whom she believed was going to be murdered in jail in October of 1960. She attended women's rallies and events to encourage and gain support for the movement. There is no MLK without Georgia Gilmore. After being fired from her job for standing up for workers' rights, Georgia sustained the Montgomery bus boycott by cooking and selling food, distributing pamphlets, and putting herself in harm's way. She led a covert organization of women who cooked and provided food and funds that sustained Blacks that were a part of this boycott for 381 days. There is no MLK without Dorothy Cotton, who served as the Southern Christian Leadership Conference's national director. King actually asked her to be and appointed her to that position. She was an educator, but she also trained countless activists in nonviolent means. She was the only female member of the executive staff and was a confidant of Dr. King. There's no MLK without college professor Joanne Robinson, who was the true brains and architect behind the Montgomery bus boycott. There is no MLK without Ella Baker, one of the founders of SNCC, the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, who organized activists, including sit-in activists, sit-in volunteers, and freedom riders. Most importantly, there is no MLK without the gospel of Jesus Christ. This is a quote from him. Evil may so shape events that Caesar will occupy a palace and Christ a cross, but one day that same Christ will rise up and split history into AD and BC, so that even the life of Caesar must be dated by his name. Another quote. Always be sure that you struggle with Christian methods and Christian weapons. Never succumb to the temptation of becoming bitter. As you press on for justice, be sure to move with dignity and discipline, using only the weapon of love. And finally, I still believe that standing up for the truth of God is the greatest thing in the world. This is the end of life. The end of life is not to be happy. The end of life is not to achieve pleasure and avoid pain. The end of life is to do the will of God, come what may. The division that exists today is kin to the division that they were experiencing right after MLK's death. Governor Lester Maddock of Georgia called him, right after his death, an enemy of our country, and threatened to personally raise the state capitol flag back from its half-mast. Ronald Reagan, who was then governor of California, described the assassination as a great tragedy, but said that it began when we began compromising with law and order and people started choosing which laws they'd break, meaning the nonviolent movement was the cause of King's death. South Carolina Senator Strom Thurmond wrote to his constituents, quote, "We are now witnessing the whirlwind sowed years ago when some preachers and teachers began telling people that each man could be his own judge in his own case." So where we go from here is actually up to us, but we look to the same scriptures Dr. King did. There is no unity without repentance and no repentance without surrender to our King. To King Jesus. The night before his assassination, Dr. King wasn't feeling very well, and he asked his friend, Reverend Abernathy, to speak on his behalf, and he ended up being persuaded to speak himself. And in his very famous last words in public, he said, "Like anybody, I would like to live a long life. Longevity has its place, but I'm concerned about that. I'm not concerned about that now. I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you, but I want you to know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land. And I'm happy tonight. I'm not worried about anything. I'm not fearing any man. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord." Before he went off to that meeting, there is a musician that played a song, King's favorite song that he liked, and he records this exchange between them when he saw him in the parking lot. And King said to him, "Man, look, tonight," as he's leaning over the railing of the room 306, "I want you to play Precious Lord tonight and play it like you've never played it before." And then the musician, Mr. Branch, responds, "Dr. King, I do that all the time." And Dr. King responds, "No, but tonight, especially for me, I want you to play it pretty tonight." And then this is what happened. This song was played and it was King's favorite song. And I want to close by reading the lyrics to the song because they're very important and they're what we stand for. And it's called Precious Lord. "When my way groweth drear, precious Lord, linger near. When my light is almost gone, hear my cry, hear my call. Hold my hand lest I fall. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me on. Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, let me stand. I am tired, I'm weak, I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home. When my work is all done and my race here is our young, let me see by the light thou hast shown. That fair city so bright, with the lantern is the light. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me on. Precious Lord, take my hand, Lead me on, let me stand. I am tired, I am weak, I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home. That is said to be the last song that Dr. King requested and heard. What I'd like us to do right now is take a moment to put in the comments, what do you think repentance looks like for us as the church? And what are some things we need to repent for both individually and as a body in light of Dr. King's life and in light of current events?
Take my hand, lead me on, let me stand. I am tired, I am weak, I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. Take my hand, precious Lord.
Amen. What a powerful challenge and reflection from Tanya. Thank you so much for your wisdom and your insight and calling us to ask that question, you know, what am I willing, how far am I willing to go, you know, to be the hands and feet of Jesus? Tanya asked us to repent this morning and to ask the question, what do we need to repent of? This morning as individuals and as a church. And so we're going to read a repentance liturgy together before we take communion. But before that, I would love to just honor some of the things that you all are sharing this morning. I see wholeheartedly, honestly denouncing the evil of white supremacy. We confess and repent. Repent observing for too long. I repent that even in the midst of COVID inequality, so many folks remain unwilling to accept that they're a direct result of systemic racism. Too many times I allow my comfort, my privilege, to make me apathetic to injustice. Of this, I repent. Thank you. The church as a whole needs to get to the real business of Jesus and not the self-serving idol they have created. Thank you. We repent. Repenting of complacency means taking action. Our repentance as the American church is needed for how we have helped minimize Black voices since this nation was founded, choosing to focus on racially motivated economic issues rather than Christ's desire for us to truly treat one another like beloved brothers and sisters. I need to repent of my comfortable place in the bosom of the empire, which I benefit from and which was built on stolen land by stolen people. I repent of my comfort. I'm trying to learn how to stand up for anti-racist principles and hold others accountable, even if I stand alone in the wilderness. We as a church need to repent of caring for what other people think and choose to value public opinion, and or who are thinking and choosing to value public opinion more than justice. Thank you. Thank you. We stand with you and repent of that as well. I think repentance requires movement, shifting away from what we recognize as wrong. We'll know we're sorry when we've changed our actions. As a church and as individuals, we have much to repent for. Repentance looks like not believing what we know how people feel, not believing that we know how people feel who have been victims of injustice, yet we must acknowledge wrongdoing and our part of perpetuating injustice, whether actively or passively. Repent staying silent about racism and injustice when I should be bringing attention to it. As a church, we must repent of our acceptance of evil and greed. My personal repentance comes from how many years of my stupid life I had the luxury of believing racism was a thing of the past, despite way too much evidence that I somehow chose to be oblivious to. Healing, praying, and resisting. Thank you so much. The church needs to repent of missing the mark of Jesus's ministry and love of all people. Oh, precious Lord, lead me on. Repent of my fear to speak truth in certain circumstances. I repent of being naive and thinking racism was a thing of the past. I repent of being silent when I should have spoken up. Churches need to repent promoting division throughout the nation now and historically. I repent the feeling of feeling so mad of how our nation treats my people and others that are different. Thank you for sharing that. So many wonderful, difficult things that you all are sharing, and thank you for having the courage to confess and repent. See, the beautiful thing is there is a path forward for us. There is even a path forward for people who have profoundly gotten it wrong. There's a path forward for those of us who have believed and been a part of a slaveholder religion for many generations. There's a path forward, and that path forward begins with what John the Baptist preached about in the wilderness. It's about repentance. It's about confession. It's about getting right with God, owning up to the things that we have done wrong, owning up to the sins of our past, to the sins of our people, and being willing to walk into the light, to step down that narrow path that Jesus has laid out before us in solidarity with all those who suffer. Thank you so much for your honesty. Thank you for your willingness to begin this process of repentance and change. And thank you, Paige. There is a path, and there is. We've got to remember that. We're not destined to be enslaved to these awful ways of thinking and living in the world. No, we can be set free, and that's the beauty of the gospel. That's the beauty of what Jesus can offer us. We truly, all of us, can be liberated from the things that are holding us back from being true disciples of Jesus Christ in solidarity with all those around us who are suffering and struggling and yearning for freedom. And so what we're going to do now is we're going to do just a short kind of liturgy together. And then after that, we will have communion together, and then we will end our time together. So thank you for being with us this morning. I encourage you, stay on till the end today. This is powerful, meaningful stuff that we're doing together, and I feel the Holy Spirit moving. The Holy Spirit's moving in spite of these limitations. So stick with us this morning. Let's pray this prayer together. Jesus, we confess that we have inherited a faith that was used to justify the theft of native lands and the enslavement of black bodies. From this, our original sin, we ask for deliverance.
Forgive us for where we have failed to understand, Lord.
And in your mercy, set us free.
Touch hearts that have been shriveled by generations of suppressed empathy and eyes that have lost the ability to see siblings who suffer from systemic injustice.
Forgive us for where we have failed to understand, Lord.
And in your mercy, set us free.
Grant us courage to renounce the false teaching that we can somehow know you without being committed to justice for all people.
Forgive us for where we have failed to understand, Lord, and in your mercy, set us free.
As we name and unlearn the habits of slaveholder religion, give us grace to draw deeply from the witness of the movements that have always resisted injustice and the power of your Spirit.
Forgive us for where we have failed to understand, Lord, and in your mercy, set us free.
We give thanks that there is a river of witnesses that flows from Sojourner Truth and Frederick Douglass to Ida B. Wells and Howard Thurman, from Rosa Parks and Martin Luther King Jr., to the prophetic leaders who guide us today. Give us grace to follow them to freedom.
Forgive us for where we have failed to understand, Lord, and in your mercy, set us free. Amen.
Amen. Well, we're going to share communion today, and communion is all about the power of the gospel, the power to set us free from all those things that keep us in bondage. The communion, the first meal, the first Lord's Supper, was likely shared as a Passover meal or around the time of Passover, and it was a powerful moment. And the Passover is looking back to the Exodus story and the way God delivered the Israelites from the hand of the empire, the Egyptian empire, who was oppressing them and enslaving them. And God set them free, and the Passover celebrates and remembers that, and remembers the great cost it took to achieve and gain their freedom. And Jesus came, and he did this on a Passover meal, and he took the bread, and he took the juice, and or the wine, and he reinterpreted that Passover meal around himself, and what he was going to offer, which is a freedom that's actually even bigger and more profound than even that powerful freedom that they achieved back in the story of Exodus. It's a freedom that's available to all of us, no matter what circumstance or situation we find ourselves in. And when we take communion, we need to remember that we worship a God who desires all people to be set free from the bondage that keeps us entrapped in wrongful thinking and wrongful action, in ways that separate us from one another and from God. And so as we share communion, I want you to know that. And I want you to go in with a humble heart, with that confession and repentance on your mind, also trusting in God's forgiveness and God's ability to set you free from the through the power of his resurrection and through the indwelling and the work of the Holy Spirit in your life. So if you want to get your food and drink, get it ready right now. If you want to share it with me right now, then I'm going to go ahead and take it. But you can get your food out, and I want you to take and eat. This is the body of Christ broken for you. If you want to get your drink, whatever you have is okay. God's Spirit can be present in that. So I want you to take and drink. This is the blood of Christ shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. God, we thank you so much for loving us. We thank you for your grace and for your goodness. We pray that these common things would be transformed into something extraordinary for us, that your Holy Spirit would fill us up, and that, God, we would be changed. We love you so much. Thank you for loving us and sticking with us. It's in your name I pray. Amen. Well, we're going to sing one more song together, and so I encourage you to join us and sing this song, and then we'll do the benediction after that. So let's sing this song to close out our time, continue in a spirit of worship, and continue to seek to connect with God.
Amen.
Well, thank you for spending your Sunday morning with us today. If you are listening later on or watching later on, thank you for taking time to connect and to be a part of this journey that we are on as a church. We're always open to newcomers, always open to people. It doesn't matter where you're at on the journey. It doesn't matter kind of what confusion you have or what you're trying to figure out. You're welcome here at our church as long as you're committed to seeking to learn more about Jesus and seeking to love your neighbor as yourself. So if you prepare yourself for the benediction, may the love of God the Father, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all, now and forever. Amen. Go in God's peace. We'll see you next time.